So we try to cover 3 points a day, and I might not be able to cover all the slides, but I'll try my best. Now, the first question we want to answer is, what is meaning therapy? Because there are more than 300 therapists, more than 300 different kinds of therapy. So what's so unique about that? So the first point I want to mention is that it is an integrative, holistic approach. We need this approach because no single therapeutic modality can meet all the needs of all people. So meaning therapy is inherently holistic because meaning is a holistic construct with all kinds of meaning. Now here's an example. Now here's a picture tells you why we need it. Now in the center, that is is you, an experiencing human being. You're feeling, you're seeing, you're behaving. But this experiencing person might not be the real you. Do you know why? Because you may be acting out of habit. You have all kinds of habits, good and bad. You have all kinds of conditioned emotional responses. So those are most of the time happening without your conscious awareness. So very often you just give a neutral response or conditioned response. So that is not loyal. Also, do you know that your conscious self, only the tip of iceberg. 90% of your self belong to the unconscious region. So there are all kinds of stuff, good and bad, in your unconsciousness. They are there because of your defense mechanism and also because of the inner working model you develop in childhood. So all this stuff are buried deep down. Often, when your defense mechanisms are weak, in a moment of weakness, the unconscious stuff may erupt and affecting you, how you behave. So, thirdly, there is the narrative self. We all make up stories about ourselves. We live by the stories we tell ourselves. Now, if your self, narrative self, is a victim, consider yourself a victim of circumstances, of unfair treatment, then you're more likely to expect and see things from the lens of a victim. So all those experiences, all the sources of influence can affect you, can shape the way you perceive the world, you respond to the world. That's why this guy in the center, if governed by these forces, he often get into trouble. In therapy, we try to allure you to three other sources. First of all, we try to encourage you to use your brain, not just the emotion, use your brain. Use your executive self to do rational thinking, to assess the situation realistically, and to reflect on yourself, what's right, what's wrong. But often a second self is not strong enough. So that's why it you have this observing self. Therefore, you need to detach yourself as an outsider looking at yourself. It's called mindfulness or mindful awareness. So basically, you detach yourself from the stimulus, from the experience. By detaching yourself, you allow some space between stimulus and response. You're able to observe more clearly what's happening. So this is a very important practice. The object was so emotionally involved, because conditional emotion is found, because of transference, because of the old story we tell to ourselves. We cannot see reality objectively, realistically. So we often kind of fight with people, respond angrily. That's why if we are able to learn how to observe ourselves as a third person called metacognition, you step up, you step behind, beyond yourself, and observe yourself, you have a better chance to see what's going on. We also can have help from our spiritual self. The spiritual self is a good side of us. Usually, it's conceptualized as meaning, or meaningfulness, or conscious, or self-transcendent, or the spirit of God. So this spiritual self, sometimes referred to awakening. So the spiritual self is not concerned about what your success or failure, whatever. The spiritual self is more concerned about your spiritual well-being, your personal growth, on how to become your best self. So spiritual self has different concerns. So we need to have a dialogue between the spiritual self and our carnal self, the expressing self. So if you're a spiritual person, you're more likely to make good decisions because your existing self is not acting alone anymore. That's why I pray all day, all night. In my dream, I pray. Because I know my inadequacy, I know my ignorance and limitation. So I pray to God for help me, guide me, give me wisdom, give me strength. So therefore, in therapy, you will be able to help clients to connect with the brain. Connect with your spirit and then become detached as a observer. So then your life will be much better. So that is the whole idea. You can see, you need some knowledge about psychoanalysis, dynamics to know the unconscious self. You know something about cognitive behavior therapy to handle the habitual self. You know something about narrative therapy to know the narrative self. And also you know something about low therapy to know about the spiritual self. Okay, so the second point is that it is relational based on existential encounter. Now, in therapy, in school, you often learn about therapeutic alliance. In other words, the therapist and the client form an alliance, helping each other. So that research has shown that it's very important. But for mini therapy, we go even further. It's not just therapeutic alliance, but we form a deep bonding. We know each other in a deeper manner. Martin Buber called that I-thou relationship. You know, it's we're to each other, we relate to each other as we relate to God. So with transparency, with authenticity, with honesty. And secondly, we value the dynamic here and now experience. Often, that a breakthrough occur here and now. So we have to be very alert to what's going on. So we seize the opportunity. And often, an inexperienced therapist, the opportunity, the breakthrough can be right before his eyes. He can see it, so let it go. So we should pay attention to here and now. And we also need to value the opportunity to know an human being in a deeper way. Now, this is a privilege, okay? So there's a special relationship between the therapist and the client. The client comes to see you, they're desperate, they need help. So they make themselves vulnerable to expose their guts before you. So we really need to value them, value this opportunity. And we appreciate the fact that they need your help. So if you do it well, the therapist, it's a therapy. In fact, you don't need to say very much. If you're able to make the client feel that you really understand them, that you really understand their struggles, you feel their pain, that is already therapy. It's a talking. Okay? So therefore, a good therapist know how to stay with the kind. So this is a long slide, but then it doesn't matter. That means sometimes the kind may be rude to you, the kind might not be helpful. Might not be listening to you, may argue with you, but in the middle of what? Okay? And you always able to treat them with care, with love, with understanding. Because here is a human being that need your help. So the way you relate to them, you show them a new pattern of relating. Sometimes it's better to be kind than to be right. Sometimes when you understand people different communication style, I saw people were soft and mild mannered. And some people like me is very direct, okay? I can talk very directly, so some people might find that not very good. But we have to learn to accept each person has a different temperament, a different way of talking. Now, the first impression is very important. What do you say and how do you greet your client? So I usually I greet a client just like I'm greeting a new friend. It's there's no pretension. Try not to be unfair, just present the way you normally do. What your client is a professor or your client is a homeless guy, you treat all of them with respect and with honesty, authenticity. The thirdly, it is a cross-cultural indigenous, which is very important because people come to you with different backgrounds. You have no idea that how culture shape our behavior or attitude or emotion. So we should have a good therapist, should have some basic understanding of different culture. More importantly, they should have the humility. The humility to ask, to learn. Tell me, how does your culture handle this issue? What's your cultural norm? So we do not assume that our way is the universal way. All Chinese are not the same. Some Chinese are born in America, some Chinese are born in China. So they might have different culture. And fourthly, it is a natural way to help clients. The fourth characteristic is that we try to stay away from manipulation, from contrived techniques. We try to use the natural way to help clients. Most human problems occur because they no longer live in harmony with nature, with themselves. So we try to help them to know who they are, their role in the world, to help them become what they are meant to be. Because every person is born with a special kind of interest and purpose. We also help them to be better connected with themselves, with ecology, with others, with God. Now, I also have plenty of people. In order to have physical health, you need good food, you need clean water, in the air. Similarly, for good mental health, you need to have meaningful work. You need to have loving relationship. You need to have a spiritual health, spiritual faith. Work, love, and faith are essential. So usually, during my first couple sessions, I try to find out if they are lacking in any of these three, they will have some difficulty in life. So here's that golden triangle is what I used to call myself meaningful therapy forever. I'm focusing on what is really meaningful for all people. I don't care whether you're CBT, whatever, but these are three areas that all people need in order to be healthy, okay? Some people ask me, now how about you, if they are atheist, they don't believe anything, but you still need to have faith in yourself, faith in other people, faith in nature, that the same will rise tomorrow, faith in the cosmos. So how do you face yourself? You cannot live, go to life without any faith. So this is golden triangle that we all need, okay? Human beings are meaning-seeking, meaning-making creature. So what we do as a meaning therapy is try to tap into people's natural capacity to make meaning and seek meaning. We also capitalize on people's need to make sense of the world and to devote themselves to do something greater than themselves. So because all the time we're trying to make sense of what's happening. Right? So that's what we are. The fourth point is that mental therapy is a spiritual therapy. Here's my friend from Ottawa. He said, at the heart of every religion or every growth psychology, it's the conviction that life has a spiritual dimension. The life must be dedicated to the fulfillment of meaning. So meaning and spirituality are intertwined. In a broader sense, to be spiritual is to be sensitive to the dimension of meaning in one's life. I think that is pretty good explanation. Now, Frankl's self-centered model of meaning spirituality, spirituality. So he is one of the few psychologists who conceptualize meaning in terms of self-transcendence and spirituality. Only to the extent that someone is living out this self-transcendence, he's truly human of his true self. So what's your true self? Your true self is your self-transcendent self. Your true self is your spiritual self. So in our meaning therapy, you try to reorient people's attention to the most important aspect. They do not have a soul, they are the soul, they are a soul, they are a spiritual being. He becomes a spiritual being by concerning himself with his subject, not with self-actualization, but by forgetting himself and turning away himself to focus outward and higher, heavenward. Discover the importance of meaning because he gone to hell. Living in Nazi concentration camp, he discovered that life is full of evil and full of suffering. The only way that he can overcome is through meaning and self-transcendence. Without that, life means despair. Now, this is a very important discovery. Okay? I want you all to extend clearly. Look, this is a simple chart, okay? Here is the horizontal dimension. Failure, success, unhappiness, happiness. People struggle on this dimension. Now, don't get me wrong. We all need success. We all need happiness. I don't pretend to be so spiritual. I don't care about success, happiness. I don't care. I don't want to be a failure in my life. So, but here is a problem. If you only concern about success and failure, even when you succeed, you still only have a shallow life. And then of success, they don't satisfy. Okay, I have all kinds of clients who are very successful. Chief surgeon, business executive, lawyer. They have success. They have everything they have achieve more than they ever dream of. But they still cannot solve the problem of inner emptiness. They still cannot be free from this nagging feeling that their life is shallow. So even your success, your life at best, you're still miserable because you live a shallow life.